right, so welcome to module 2, managing the supply chain. So this module focuses more on that second part of the course's name. Remember, this is operations and supply chain. Module 1 was more about how operations can create value. The second part, this module 2, is going to present you with an overview on the basics of what is a supply chain. So let us start. What I'm expecting you to learn is the following. Number one, to distinguish between these two terms, value chain and supply chain. A lot of people confuses them both. You won't. Number two, to assemble an overview of the supply chain network for a given company. So number two is about visualizing or sketching an overview of how goods are moving in these chains of organizations or companies which are interconnected. Remember, goods are going to be transformed until they reach to their final stage. So all this story can be visualized. Number three, to identify the main activities that are happening there at the supply chain. And lastly, to understand the challenges facing supply chains, like COVID-19 virus. I think that is a challenge, don't you think? All right, so first of all, a model. That's what I'm going to present you, a value chain model. Models are there to simplify complexity, because value chains are quite complex, and are complex due to the many activities that are happening there. Just think about it, inside of an organization, all the activities that are happening, not just in the production of goods or services, but also in everything around. I'm talking about HR related activities like recruitment, selection of people, interviews that are involved in that, all the compensation related aspects. Think about all the procurement of raw materials, all the IT support, all the accounting activities that are happening. So there are many, many things which are happening there, and we need to organize them by some kind of rationale, right? So this model is going to help us on that. It's going to help us on how to organize these activities. And the model was created by Michael Porter in 1985. And by the way, that's him. Although I'm not really sure if he still looks like in that picture. Well, but that's just the picture I got. And yes, that's, he's very popular, because a lot of the models that you are going to learn or have learned are from him, like Porter's Five Forces, for instance. Yes, that's the Porter. That's the Professor Porter. Now, the objective of the value chain model is to map out these activities, to visualize them in a way that people can easily understand them. And it relies on basically on a template, and the template looks like this. So you see these empty boxes, and you also see here in purple color something that reads support activities and primary activities. And that is basically the first categorization of the activities which are happening within an organization. In other words, not everything that happens inside of an organization has equal weight. Some activities are more important than others, more important to create money, to create a margin, right? So if we have a closer look, you will recognize there is a little bit of a difference how these boxes are arranged. You will notice that the primary activities are sequential boxes, as if something happens here and then it follows, and then this one follows, etc. Whereas a support activity is more like a platform that is in contact with all these activities. So let us have a closer look, and I think I will explain myself a bit better. Okay, so now here you have a kind of the standard model of how the value chain of a given company might look like. Now, again, this, don't take this, take this with, how do they say, with a pinch of salt. Very careful, because not every organization contains the same type of activity. This is kind of a generic type of organization, what we see here. And what we see here in this red frame are the primary activities. Primary activities are the core activities, are the most important activities. In other words, if you want to make money, you better have a look at your core, because that's where the value gets created. So primary activities directly concerned with the creation or delivery of the product or service. Yeah, let us have a closer look. What do we have here? Well, we have inbound logistics, operations, outbound logistics, marketing and sales, and after sales services. So going more into details, inbound logistics, all those materials that are coming from suppliers to our organization, they are all arriving. So there are a lot of activities around that. They are handled, they are stored, and eventually they are transformed. This is really now really adding value to that material. We are transforming that rock into a diamond, so to say. Eventually we have to store it. We might not want to have that product waiting too long in that storage because that costs money. We want to basically push it into the market as fast as we can. So all these outbound logistics are is basically the distribution channels, right? So it goes to the market and it will go and reach specific target groups or segments and locations, etc., etc., defined by marketing. And it will be deployed by, well, the sales department, the sales force. Eventually, we will have for sure some services because we just don't want to sell only a tangible good. We also want to sell a service, right? Sometimes a service might involve guarantees. So all these kind of telemarketing, all these 1-800 phone calls, well, they belong here. Repairs, guarantees, recollection of goods, etc., etc. Okay, so these are the primary activities. Now let's go into the support activities. So support activities are there to facilitate the transformation of these goods, right? You don't make money by buying goods or by, I don't know, giving the best IT support or by just hiring people or by creating financial reports. No. You create financial reports as to assist the decisions that managers need to do, right? You're not selling financial, well, you could sell some financial reports, of course, but that is not the purpose of your business. The same would apply for recruitment. You want to have the best person at the best moment in time. That's their job, and that is how they support the core process. Same applies for IT, same applies for procurement, and for other type of activities. Again, this is not exhaustive. There could be just more. What matters to you is to differentiate between primary and support activities. This is what matters, and that is the message of this module. Okay, so coming back to an example that I like a lot, we can apply this model to many different type of businesses and organizations, for example, a university, yeah? And we might try to answer the following questions. What is the primary process? What could be examples for support activities? What is the raw material that gets transformed? So, how would you answer these questions? Well, what is the reason for existence for a university, but nothing but education? So education, of course, should be here, should be at the core, at the primary process. And what is being transformed? What is the rock that is transformed into that beautiful diamond that the market would like to buy? That's right, the students. So here we have our inbound logistics, which is nothing but the means in which students arrive to our university, And then they are being transformed, where transform means a learning process in which students develop skills, competences, experiences, etc., knowledge, and eventually they will graduate. And this has a lead time, a time for transformation. Theoretically speaking, or in essence, should last no more than 4 years. But you know, sometimes it takes a little bit longer, and someone needs to pay for that, by the way. So that is how, that is basically the primary process for a university, where a student could be seen as a raw material that gets transformed. Now, everything like IT support, for example, cafeteria or facilities, everything falls here. Support. All managerial tasks, all the guys with fancy suits walking here and there are just there to provide support to the classroom. The classroom is at the core of the value creation in this type of business. Now, when you look at things from this perspective, well, it helps to clarify how you want to allocate resources, doesn't it? I mean, if at the end what matters is the primary process, hence that's why it's called the primary process, then you want to have the best facilities, the best teachers as you can have, because that's how you create value. So let's go back to our initial goal. What is the difference between value chain and supply chain? And let's answer that by answering, what is a supply chain? A supply chain is basically a network. It's a network of links. These links are companies. We're talking about suppliers. We're talking about OEMs, or original equipment manufacturers. And we are also talking about customers. And goods or materials are flowing from left to right, in which transformation happens right at the core, right at the manufacturer. In the business jargon, this is known as the upstream side, and this is called the downstream, as if this would be, I don't know, some kind of a river in which things are flowing. So it's the same here. So here we have the supply side of the chain, and here we have the demand side of the supply chain. Let me show you an example. Let's think about a plastic homeware manufacturer like Tupperware, also known in Germany as Tupperware, I think. Well, Tupperware would have its own set of suppliers. Let's say that in this case, let's just come up with just two. Those suppliers that directly deliver materials to the OEM, we call them first tier suppliers, or tier one. Yeah, those are the ones directly in contact with the OEM. Now, obviously, those suppliers have their own suppliers as well. Those would be called, therefore, the second tier of suppliers, or tier two. Now, you might see that whereas here you might have sub-assemblies in some cases, or kind of semi-finished goods, on the second tier suppliers, now you have really like the raw materials, the plastic pellets, the inks, etc., etc. Okay, so this is the supply side, obviously oversimplified. On the right side, the demand side, we would have our distribution channels. Think, for instance, a wholesaler. That could be a first-tier customer. Now, the wholesaler will distribute eventually to their retailer. Now, we can also distribute goods from the OEM directly to the retailer. We would call them, with the same logic, the second tier customers, or tier two. So here we would have assembled the big kind of overview of the supply chain for this Tupperware company, in which we have flows. And you notice here on this remark, on this note, that we have direct supply and information, because these are materials flowing from the left side, the supply side, to the market side, to the demand side. And at the same time, we have information flows. What kind of information do you think is flowing? Well, how about customer preferences? Maybe some customers prefer blue color rather than yellow. And there is a proportion of, I don't know, 70% to 30%. this kind of information that happens at the point of sales is being collected and communicated on real time as to the manufacturer to readjust their plans and restock according to whatever is needed in the market. So again, a big overview of the supply chain of a plastic good like Tupperware. Here's another example, a shopping mall. Now we are in the realm of services. Okay, so it's the same logic as before. A shopping mall is having suppliers. What kind of suppliers? Security services, cleaning services, maintenance services. Those, at the same time, they would have their own suppliers, recruitment agencies for those security guards, cleaning materials for those cleaning services, equipment suppliers for the maintenance services. With the same logic, on the demand side, we would have the first-tier customers. Those would be the retailers who expect something from the shopping mall, from the administration of the shopping mall. And eventually, the second-tier customers who are basically the retail customers experiencing whatever the retailer is providing them. So once again, you have a supply chain network for services, in this case for shopping malls, in which you also have materials flowing, but also information flowing on the opposite side. Okay, so moving on. So how can we relate these supply chains with the concept of the value chain? Well, value chains interact on complex networks, which are these supply chains. Let me show you an example. This, by the way, is an old factory from the 50s. That's a Ford factory. And back then, the network looked like this. You have an assembly line, components arrive. In this case, well, if you are assembling a Ford, well, you have a Ford seat that probably was also manufactured right there at the same facility of Ford. So you had a kind of a simple value chain in which, of course, some raw materials arrive, they all get transformed, and eventually a final product is being done. Nowadays, it's not so linear. Nowadays, it's more like a web. So they will look something like this. So you might have General Motors, Ford, for instance, competitors that share many of these suppliers. So you can see here how some of the first tier suppliers are shared by both. Sometimes they even cooperate, these companies. That's the reason why you get to see, I don't know if you have noticed on the highway, that you see similar cars, basically it's the same car, but with different badges. Have you recognized that? It turns out that these cars were manufactured on the same facility. They just make agreements like that. So those competitors, they also cooperate in certain type of businesses. And because of this complexity, our value chain is so interconnected that resemble what you see here. It's more like a web. So that is a modern era of supply chains. So every element of this, every entity that plays a role here, well, they have their own value chain. They are responsible for the operation of whatever is happening here. And yet, they all have to coordinate themselves like a good orchestra. So they all have to aim for the same goal. What would that be, that goal? Well, whoever is going to drive that car, that amazing Ford Mustang, he better have the best experience of his life. And that experience is going to come by the cooperation from all these companies. Okay, so I don't think to tell you, I guess, that supply chains are borderless. They don't see themselves anymore as, you know, American companies or French companies. They don't recognize borders. As long as the countries have commercial agreements, they will try to assemble and design the most efficient and effective architecture to create whatever product they're doing. So here you see, once again, a construction. Now it's just vertical. So you see the supply side, tier one, tier two, tier three. And on top, you have the demand side. You also see a bunch of flags from different countries that highlight the internationality of this network. Once again, You have supplier of materials highlighted with yellow blocks and suppliers of services. So what could be a service in this context? Well, think about transportation, third-party logistics, but also cleaning services, perhaps, security guards. So all these companies are part of this equation. So now, just to illustrate what I'm trying to show you here, I have the following example. I remember back then when Mr. Trump was running for president, one of his slogans, in addition to build the wall, and Mexico should pay for it, was buy American, buy American. So you have all those cowboys in Texas, perhaps, buying their nice pickup truck, Ram Charger. And the irony of that is that a product like this, like the one you get to see here, is just 59% made in America. Whereas a Japanese, in brackets, Honda Civic, sorry, Honda Accord, is 81% made in America. So you see the irony of all this? So these networks are so complex that you can no longer create walls that will disrupt these flows. So it's not good for anybody. Well, I guess it's just good for political rhetorics, I guess. If you want to read more about this article, you can find here the link. It's interesting. It's an eye-opener. Okay, so moving on. Our second goal was, what are the main activities happening within the supply chain? So many things are happening there, and somehow we need to categorize them, we need to standardize them so that we can all speak in the same language. After all, we are talking here about international companies. So, for that reason, voila, once again, I'm presenting you another model. So this would be now the second model that I'm showing you. And this model's name is SCOR. SCOR is an acronym that stands for Supply Chain Operations Reference. So it's a reference, it's a standard, and that standard was created some decades ago by several companies, American companies, if I remember well. So this is basically a framework, and because it's a model, it tries to simplify all the activities happening within these three links. So what are the main activities? Well, let us start with a very strategic one, which is called planning. You have to plan. You have to plan all sorts of things. Think about planning resources that you need, materials. You need to plan locations. So where are you going to produce? So you have planning at all levels. So that is where everything starts. So all these activities, all these processes, they fall under the umbrella of planning. We also have sourcing. You have done your planning, what you need to produce, when you need to produce. Now you buy those materials when you need them. You don't want to buy them beforehand, because then you have to store them for a long time. They can get damaged. It costs a lot of money anyways just to store them. So you want to execute that sourcing in accordance to your plan. Planning also includes a target cost. So you have certain target costs that you have to achieve. So there is a lot of negotiations happening between the original equipment manufacturer and suppliers. That falls into source. We have the making. What are the technologies that we are going to use to make that product? How are we going to do it? Where we are going to do it? Are we going to do it in our facilities? Are we going to outsource that production to someone else? Because, I don't know, it's more flexible, perhaps? So these kind of decisions goes into making. Now, you deliver whatever you have to make, and that is basically the logistics, what people call logistics. And you might have also a return. What could be a return? Well, I don't know. I mean, maybe you buy beer, and then you drank your beer, you bring it back to this store, and then you have a complete reverse supply chain that is returning all those empty bottles so that they can be reused. That is an example of return. Return could also be I don't know, you buy a nice pair of Nikes and turns out that you just don't like them anymore, and you just return them back with a Nike would provide you with a sticker, you just put it back again on the box, and that's it, as simple as that. So there is a lot of effort. We as customers, we don't think about that, but there's a lot of effort behind, and there are processes behind. These processes, these are return. And all this, you need to make it in a very effective, very efficient, fast way. That is what we call enabling. So when we're talking about technology, we are also talking about people, having the right people. Whatever resource you need, whatever support process, remember that from Porter, whatever support process that facilitates the above, these are the enablers. Okay, so let me just quickly illustrate this with a small business example, and I just came up with this hot dog stand that you see here. Okay, so even though it's a very simple business, you can still apply the SCOR model. Here, by the way, it's not SCOR E. Well, yeah, E because of enable. Sometimes you normally find it as SCOR, but okay, I thought I made a mistake, but now I realize I didn't. Okay, so SCOR. Planning. Okay, so let's plan how many hot dogs you will make. Which type of hot dogs and how many of each. So like, think about proportions, think about percentages. Where to make them and where to sell them. Hey, do you want to be in front of that famous discotheque in Dusseldorf so that you can, be very attractive to all those kind of after party customers? Well, you need to find that, you have to plan that location. Now you have to source, you need to buy ingredients. Maybe you go to Metro, could be an option, you know, the wholesaler. So where to buy ingredients at an attractive price, because hey, this is a business, huh? So you want to buy with the lowest and sell it with the highest. You want to negotiate the best quality and service with that price. So this is sourcing. Now you're going to make the product, and you have to decide how you're going to make it. And maybe it's just a humble hot dog, but you have to make decisions. Are you going to assemble the hot dog right on the spot based on demand? You know, so that it's just fresh, nice, and crunchy because you just made it for that customer? Or are you going to kind of prepare first the hot dogs, and in the moment the customers arrive, they will, you know, point at which hot dog they want to have, and then you will do the final assembly at the very end? That could be kind of a pull-push hybrid approach. So these kind of decisions, you know, have to happen here. And, you know, don't take them for granted, because the secret for success could be hidden here. I mean, if you have seen the movie The Founder, which is about the founder of McDonald's, hey, you will understand what I'm talking about. You really need to watch that film if you haven't, for educational purposes. Do yourself a favor, The Founder. Okay, so coming back, make. Plan, source, make. What else? Deliver. How are you going to deliver your goods? Are customers coming and picking up their hot dogs? Is that what you want to have? Or are you bringing those hot dogs to the tables? Or are you bringing those hot dogs to their homes and offices of those customers? Why not? Maybe you do that during weekdays, on weekends. You just do it differently for those party guys. So you can play with this. I mean, after all, you want to maximize profit, isn't it? So you have to find the right kind of the sweet spot of combining all these variables and options. Okay, so plan, source, make, deliver, return. Okay, so what could be returned back? Well, maybe the trash, you know, the plates, the napkins. Are they doing it, the customers, by themselves? Or do you have to collect that? I mean, it's just like McDonald's. In McDonald's, you have to do it on your own. At some other imbiss or restaurants, you just don't do it. So, same question here. And lastly, enable. Enable hiring people with specific skills, how to find these people, what kind of recruitment channels are you going to use? Online, Facebook, newspaper, job fair, for instance, how are you going to measure their performance? By their rate, by their speed, how fast they can assemble a hot dog, by identifying needs on customers, so the average sale per person. So you have to think about KPIs for that. So you see, that would be the SCOR model applied to a humble hot dog. Now think about other type of businesses. Think about a university, think about a hospital, think about whatever you can. So, okay, so coming back, so a formal definition for the supply chain management would be the following. So if the supply chain is a network, what is then management? Well, there is the management of the upstream and downstream relationships with suppliers and customers in order to deliver superior customer value at a lower cost to the supply chain as a whole. The definition that I like for any kind of management is basically about planning. It's about executing what you plan. It's about monitoring that whatever you plan is actually happening. And if that is not happening, well, then you have to make a correction and plan again. That's what some people call the PDCA cycle. Once again, the PDCA cycle: plan, do, check, act. So plan, do, check, act could be basically management. So how you plan, execute your supply chain, monitor your supply chain by means of KPIs, key performance indicators. And if these goals are not met, well, maybe there is something you have to tweak or adjust, and then plan again. So this is a formal definition. I just took it from the Financial Times. Now, as said, there are many flows in this stream. Obviously, we have a material flow in this direction. We have information flow, mostly demand related. So what items are most popular, which items are not popular, what kind of demand are they having, which locations, etc., etc. But we also have financial flow. For example, payments. So customers need to pay. But also you have financial flow on the opposite direction, which are the credits. Because sometimes customers don't have the money, so you give them the credit, or the supplier gives them the credit. This is very common. So that is the reason why financial flows go bidirectional. You also have a material ownership or risk. So you buy a product, and that product is being shipped on a container from China to Europe, and I don't know, maybe it is intercepted by some Somalian pirates, you know, right on the sea. So who is losing the money here? Who owns that product? Is it you? Is it the manufacturer? Well, you have the so-called Incoterm. So you have a lot of contracts that clarify these kind of things. So this risk can be also seen as something that is flowing within the supply chain. So you see, there are many things flowing: materials, information, financials, and even risk due to the ownership. Okay, so last question. What are the challenges facing supply chains? Well, let me show you here. First of all, nowadays, we are no longer sensible to what supply chains are capable of. And what you see here are some figures, some statistics. And believe me, these statistics that make us so happy as customers are thanks to the effort of operations. Yeah, is delivering that promise. Because when you manage to create an idea, which is something to wear, and to sell it right on the store within 2 weeks, like Sara is doing, that's operations. That's pure operations. That speed, how you create that development process, that product development process. If you manage to deliver goods from groceries within 2 hours by means of Amazon Prime Now, 2 hours order to delivery, hey, that's operations. If you manage to create 1 billion possible configurations for a Ford F-150 pickup truck, Again, not 1 million, 1 billion. That is 1,000 million configurations. That's operations happening. That's supply chain magic. 630 million packages delivering during a holiday season. 34.4 million items ordered on Prime Day. I mean, these are millions of boxes on one day. Just for the record, 35,000 Lord of the Rings Blu-ray sets on one single day. I mean, it's just crazy. But we as customers, well, we demand things more complex, better, tailor-made, faster. So as customers, we are demanding more and more and more. And operations managers, supply chain managers make that happen. Yeah. So that is the added value of the chain of supplies. Okay, so, but things can go wrong. They can go south, as they say, and there are many disruptions as the ones you see here. Some of these disruptions are natural disruptions. Think about Fukushima. That was in Japan, 2001. Some disruptions might not be natural, might be political. Like, think about Brexit, the disruption that Brexit creates in the supply chain, or an individual that, you know, is promising walls here and there. It could also be a virus, which by now, I mean, when I did that slide, that was, I don't remember, February 2020. I couldn't even imagine the impact of that little thing was going to create in the world. So these are all sort of disruptions. By the way, these are brand new Toyotas. Look how they, it's a chain. And in that region of Fukushima, there were also manufacturers for the chips, for computer chips. And due to that, it created scarcity, because the chips couldn't be produced anymore, and prices skyrocket, and that impact on the final goods like laptops and all sort of things, electronics in general. So that just to show you. So these are disruptions, and sometimes we experience, I mean, we rarely see them, but when we see these disruptions, we really suffer. And here's a picture I took back then in 2015. That was at Aldi. In Duisburg, in the city of Duisburg, when I used to live there. And I was shocked to what I saw. Just empty shelves, as you can see here. So obviously something happened in this supply chain. And when that happened, all this is loss of sales. This is money that has been lost. I wanted to buy my Gouda cheese, not possible anymore. I wanted to buy yogurt, etc., etc., no more possible anymore. So I'm leaving this store with empty hands. Bye bye. No money for you, Mr. Aldi. Well, Aldi brothers. So, yeah, so this is a disruption, a very real disruption. By the way, just for the record, if you take pictures at Aldi, you are not allowed to do it. It's a lesson that I learned. Enablers. Well, put all the pictures here. Okay, so as enablers, facilitators, and these are the good news, we have tons of technologies happening. We also have agreements like the ones you see here. So let us start with just a big overview. We have something that is very exciting, which are the so-called drone logistics. So nowadays, Amazon, Pizza Hut, for instance, they are testing ideas of how they can deliver goods by means of using drones. And there's a huge debate about that. I mean, there are a lot of benefits, but also some people just don't like the idea of having these things all over the place. So I think eventually we will find a middle point where it is reasonable to have that. We also have, again, also very controversial, unmanned vehicles. These are vehicles that can drive by their own, just like this truck that you see here with all sort of sensors, radars, lidars, that's laser radar, by the way. So I don't know how long, I think the technology is already there, but the legal aspect that is around is not ready. That is the reason why we don't get to see them yet, but eventually they will be there. Augmented reality, just like Pokemon Go. I mean, you can wear some kind of glasses. And well, that would be, in the case of logistics, that would be a warehouse where an operator can really navigate and find whatever goods they wish to. So it's like you have a combination of it's a picking process with reading device, with navigation, kind of GPS, with communication, all sort of things. So you feel like Iron Man here in the warehouse. You also have additive manufacturing, also known as 3D printing. Also very exciting and very disruptive in a way, but I think also opens a lot of opportunities because you no longer need to produce overseas if you can just print them locally. But I don't know, maybe those printers can be assembled again overseas in Vietnam or wherever, Mexico. Unless, I don't know, it could also be that you have printers that print printers. And okay, I mean, why not? So, but let's see where this technology is taking us. But this is going to disrupt a lot of things because we can even print food. Can you imagine that? You can print your own pizza. I'm still waiting for that time, for that moment. So you don't need to, you know, to make a phone call and to wait for the guy to arrive at home. No, you just, I don't know, buy the recipe and just print it if you have the raw materials at home. So, and these flags, well, these are commercial agreements that also enable all these transactions happening within the supply chain. So that's US, Mexico, Canada, and that is Southeast Asia, basically, countries. Oh, how can I forget that? I always forget this because of the animation. Blockchain technology, I mean, that is something super important within the supply chain. I mean, you probably have heard of Bitcoin. Bitcoin relies on this technology. But this technology is used, for example, in the wine industry, where you can really trace where those grapes are coming from. If you happen to be like some kind of wine freak or wine connoisseur or so. Not me. Okay, so a lot of enablers in the supply chain, a lot of good news. Lots of things are happening here. I remember that just like it was yesterday. We were at school and we were taken to a school trip, and that school trip was to a factory, and that factory was about a bottling company. This company is called FEMSA. It's very big in Mexico, it's very big in my city called Monterrey. And well, they basically have Coca-Colas and beer, by the way. And I got to see the production line, and I was so impressed to what I was looking and all this machinery, the noises, the people, the beeps, the colors, that I was so impressed. And I knew in that very day that one day I was going to get involved into an operation like that. The field I discovered later was called operations management and supply chain. Who knows? Maybe this will be the beginning of your experience. Let's see.